Good morning.
Good morning.
Spring has sprung and it's not leaking. I tend to be a little slow. Thank you. Just the past few months, I actually watched Duck Dynasty. Those guys are nuts. What a hoot. Last week, we wrapped up our series on the fruit of the Spirit. So, we finished that. I know. I told you, I'm slow. We are moving into resurrection, first fruits, Passover. We have quite a few things coming up over the course of the next few weeks. I know I had a bulletin, I just saw it. There it is. In your bulletin, open it up, take a look. I'm kind of doing the announcements early. On the inside page, on the right-hand side at the top, we talk about the Seder dinner, okay? I want to take a minute and explain to you guys what that is, okay? The Seder dinner is the traditional dinner that the Jews do to commemorate the Passover, okay? Now, we're not doing that quite that way, because the Jews do this looking forward to a Messiah to come. We're doing this looking backward at a Messiah that has come. So what we've done, and Dennis and Jeannie and Steve and Angie and Kelly and Michelle previously, there were some other people that were involved, but over the course of the years, this has evolved into is taking what they are looking forward to and explaining how we are looking back on this, how Jesus has already fulfilled everything that they're looking forward to in the Passover dinner. So what I would like to encourage you to do, we are actually opening it up so we have more room. We're looking probably about 70 or more people that we can fit in this year, rather than about 40 or 45 that we've done previously. I would like as many of you as possible to come to this, because all too often, we tend to completely separate Easter and Good Friday. And on our Good Friday, we're celebrating the Passover, but we're celebrating something that has been accomplished, and we're wrapping Good Friday into that. And the Sunday service for Resurrection Sunday is going to be keyed off of where the Seder ends. So it's going to be one big thing. We're doing Friday night, Good Friday, and then we are doing Sunday, the Resurrection Sunday. We're building off of each other. Okay? Sign up sheets are over there. Sign up. Come. See how God had demonstrated in His Word from the Old Testament up into the New Testament, and from the New Testament to now, how He has said He will fulfill what He has said He would do. And we get to see a lot of the fulfillment of that in this service. Okay? So sign up over there. I am really excited about what's going to be going on. If you've been to one before, come again. All right? I think it's that important. So, having said that, Easter. Yes, sir.
Will there be child care at the Seder
dinner? We're bringing duct tape.
We can probably work that out.
What's that?
We can probably work that out.
Yes, that will be worked out. That will be worked out. You threw me off track. No. I was done with duct tape. Easter! It is not about the bunny. Okay? I had a dream a couple nights ago, and I'm going to share this with you. I personally believe that God speaks to us today, and I believe that this dream that he gave me was significant. Okay? In my dream, we were at church. We were having a church service, and we were sitting at tables. There were two rows of tables sitting like this, and Christy and I were sitting at a table up here, and we were looking over some notes, and there was a young man sitting at a table here with his back to me, and there was another young man that sat over there with his back to me. And as we were going through the notes, a conversation arose about movies. What movies are appropriate to watch? And this young man that was sitting over here, he's about 17 years old, he was talking about these movies that, this movie is pretty good to watch. There's nothing really offensive about it. There's a little bit of language. There's no nudity. There's not a lot of violence. And this movie's good to watch. There's violence, but it's kind of, it's appropriate to the movie. And then this guy over here started engaging with him, and they were talking about these movies that were appropriate to watch. And at one point in the conversation, I said, I just need to ask you a question. And he said, what's that? I said, why is it that you classify one movie where the guy and the girl are talking and they fall in love and they go in the room and you won't watch it because they go in the room and they're doing what they shouldn't be doing in public? But you will watch a movie where these two are talking about what they're going to do and then they go in the movie and close the door and you just picture in your head what they're doing. And he kind of looked at me and said, well, I don't know. Now, there was a young man sitting in the back, far back over on my left, that stood up and he said, I think I need to tell you guys what's going on here. He said, see, you guys have been made aware, you're wise, to the overt attack of the enemy. The overt attack. What's in your face? What you can see. But what you've missed is the subversive attack of the enemy. And I woke up at that point, okay? And I laid in bed and I pondered it, and I told Christy when she and I were talking, because I dream every night. I have multiple dreams. Some of them are just weird. Some of you guys do weird stuff in my dreams, all right? But I believe that one was God speaking to my heart, okay? I had already started preparing this message. Hey Jack, it ain't about the bunny. It ain't about the bunny. And I wanted to go through and I wanted to list what the Easter traditions are versus the reality of what we celebrate. Okay? And I started doing some research online, and you know what I've come up with? Absolutely, I've come up with, nobody has a clue. Okay? Now, we know Easter comes from the name Esther, which is actually a derivative of Yoster, who was a Teutonic goddess of fertility. Okay? So when you're saying Happy Easter, you're actually referring back to a Teutonic goddess. Okay? And the celebration that she would have every year, they would gather together to celebrate, and in some cultures it was called the Festival of Beltane. Okay? Now, that might sound a little familiar to you, because in October, they would celebrate the festival of Samhain, okay? And Samhain was death, because fall, everything was dying, and it was being turned over to death, and then they had the winter months. Well, then spring came, and they had the festival of Beltane, which was the goddess of life, and everything's being regenerated and being made anew, okay? Now, this goddess, Eostre, one of her things that they would used to symbolize her was the rabbit. Why? Because they produce stinking fast. Bum, 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 bum. We have people in our church that are like that. Amen? That's one way to grow a church. And we love it because children are precious in God's sight. All right? So they would have this rabbit that they would actually use to symbolize this goddess, all right? And over the course of time, actually, the earliest reference to the Easter rabbit that we have is in about 1548. In the 1800s, between 1600 and 1800, Germanic immigrants from Germany, because that's where Germanic immigrants come from, Germany. That's how it works, if you didn't know. They moved from there and they came to the U.S. A lot of them settled in the Pennsylvania area. And they brought with them some of their customs. The Easter Bunny. Now, the Easter Bunny would come and would lay eggs. Germans, they got this weird engineering thing. But they're not so good on just agricultural things, okay? But the Easter Bunny would lay these eggs and hide them around, and then you'd go and you'd find the egg, and if you found the egg, you'd be blessed, all right? And then eventually that evolved into you would take eggs and you would put them in a nest for the Easter Bunny to come, and the Easter Bunny wouldn't have to lay an egg. The Easter Bunny would take your egg and then put a prize or a gift in the nest. That's where the Easter basket comes from. Now, all of that to say this, that's one line of thinking, okay? One line of thinking. The reality is, there are people that say absolutely not, the name Easter is actually a mistranslation from another word in German that was trying to translate from Latin, and it refers to the white robes that were traditionally worn during the Passover season, during the celebration of the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. They wore white clothing to be baptized in. And the word Easter is a derivative of the German word for white robes or white clothes. Okay? And where do the Easter eggs come from? Well, in Eastern Orthodoxy, they would take eggs and they would paint them red to represent the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Okay? So there's another line of thinking. All of that to say this. Flip open to Colossians, if you would, please. We're going to turn to Colossians chapter 2. I'm going to pick up in verse 16. So Colossians 2, starting in verse 16. Paul is writing, he says, "Therefore, let no one pass judgment on you in question of food and drink, or with regard to a festival or a new moon or a Sabbath. These are a shadow of the things to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. Let no one disqualify you, insisting on asceticism and worship of angels, going on in detail about visions, puffed up without reason by a sensuous mind, and not holding fast to the head, from whom the whole body, nourished and knit together through its joints and ligaments, grows with the growth that is from God. If with Christ you die to the elemental spirits of the world, why, as if you were still alive in the world, do you submit to regulations? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. Referring to things that all perish as they are used, according to human precepts. These indeed have the wisdom, have the appearance of wisdom in promoting self-made religion and asceticism and severity to the body, but they are of no value in stopping the indulgence of the flesh." So, is it okay to give a chocolate Easter bunny? Maybe. Is it okay to paint Easter eggs? Maybe. Is it okay to send my children or grandchildren on an Easter egg hunt? Did you actually hide eggs? Man, I got almost a 2-hour break one time. They're out in the field, go. They didn't find a one because they're sitting on the table in a basket. The maybe is because of this. What are you celebrating? The reality is Christ. Okay? The reality is Christ. Now, Easter, Resurrection Sunday, First Fruits, what are we celebrating? Come on.
Resurrection.
The resurrection. We're celebrating something that has never in the history of the world been done. The very nature of creation was changed because God became part of His creation. Okay? Now, think about this for a moment. Adam and Eve brought sin into this world. They chose wrongly. And they separated themselves from God by that choice. What was that choice? We want to be like God. We are discontent with our place in life where God has put us. And we want more. We want to be like Him. I think that wasn't as good as they were hoping it would be. So sin comes in. All people from that point to this have been born into sin. As a matter of fact, David says they are conceived in sin. So sin's a problem. Man can no longer come before God because God is absolutely righteous and He requires absolute righteousness. So this chasm has opened up between us and God. And how do we get from here to there? There is nothing that we can do to bridge that gap. Nothing. Because we all sin. We are all born into sin. Okay? So there's nothing we can do to bridge the gap. Well, you know, I'm kind of just hoping when I stand before God, He'll look at the good I've done and the bad that I've done, and the good will outweigh the bad. See, the problem is, if there's anything in the bad that is not covered by the blood of Christ, anything in the bad will immediately outweigh all the good. Why? Because God is perfect in His justice. Absolutely perfect. So if you stand before God with any unrighteousness whatsoever, you're out. It's that simple. But God knew what was going to happen. Okay? God is omniscient. He knows everything. You guys didn't know I was going to do that, did you? See, you're not God. God knew I was going to do that. All right? So right there, I have just demonstrated to everyone in this room that you are not God. You are not omniscient. I bet you the devil didn't know I was going to do that. Okay? So God, looking down over the course of everything, determined this is what I will do that man can be reconciled to me, that man can be restored to a right relationship with me. I am going to take of myself, my son, I will put him in human form. He will live as they live. He will face every temptation that they face. He will succumb to none of them. And yet, they will condemn him to die. And he will go to a cross, and he will bear all sin for all time, and impute, give to them my righteousness. Because his righteousness is the only righteousness that allows you in his presence. So, God put a plan in motion. He declared a people to be his own. Hey, Abram. Yeah? Move. Where? Just go. Get up and go. I'll show you. Go. Well, okay. Hey, guys. Mom, dad, siblings. I gotta go. Go where? I don't know. A place that God is showing me. He's taken me somewhere. And then God met with Abram, and he made a covenant with him. And that covenant was sealed in blood. And the presence of God walked through the halves of the animals, through the blood. And he said, "You will be mine. Of all the people in the world, I have chosen you and all of your descendants to be my very own, my possession. You're mine." Okay? Thus came the nation of Israel. You ever have any wonders about what's going on with the nation of Israel? They're still his. Take a look in Romans chapter 11. God has not relinquished them. Though for a time, they are in rebellion. They have not done as he told them to do. That's for our benefit, that the Gentiles might be gathered in. He will bring them back to being his people. He's never disqualified ownership of Israel. All right? So when you hear me talking about Israel, do you know why Israel is so important to me? Because they're important to God. And his word is Israel-centric, not America-centric. So God created a people. Why? So that through them, he could bless the world. Okay? We see that all throughout the Old Testament. God gave a law. Why did God give the law? God put a law in place so that we would understand that there is absolutely no way we can fulfill everything that is required for us to be righteous. No way. We can't do it. And then he put into place a sacrifice. Because without blood being shed, there is no forgiveness of sin. You cannot be forgiven of sin without blood being shed. Why? Because life is in the blood. All right? With me so far? So now God has established this. He's put it in place. He gave them the law. He gave them the prophets, all of which were pointing as a huge flashing neon sign to one event. And that was the life of Jesus Christ. And more importantly, it was his death. Because being perfect without sin, now keep in mind, Jesus really put a much larger burden on us than the law did, because the law simply talked about your actions. But Jesus says, "I tell you the truth, if you think it, you've done it." So it's not just about what you do. Well, gosh, I've never killed anyone. Man, if you thought, "Man, I wish that person were dead," there's sin. "I don't hate anyone. I really don't." CNN, MSNBC. "Why don't those people just go rot?" Or Fox. "Those people just have no clue." See, Jesus revealed that our problem is not with what we do, it's with who we are, what we are. Okay? So, when he went to the cross, not only did he not commit any sin, but he had nothing inside of him that could be even thought of as sin. So he went to the cross absolutely perfect. And then died, was placed in a tomb. Would that have been sufficient? Three days later, God gave proof to what was done on the cross. Because early in the morning, the world was shaken. The stone was rolled away. The stone was not rolled away so Jesus could get out. The stone was rolled away so we could get in. So we could go in and see, he's not here anymore. He is risen. Don't believe me? Hey, look. One of the first appearances he did, he came into a room that was locked. You think a rock would have stopped him? Nah. It wasn't for his sake, it was for ours. So, Easter. Well, where are you going with this? Easter. Look, if your fixation on that day is bunnies and chicks and colorful Easter eggs and chocolate and jelly beans, if that's your focus, Satan has drawn your attention away from the reality of Jesus Christ. That's subversive. Okay. Now everybody gets up in arms at Halloween. Oh, the day of the devil! Demons and scary, icky, yucky things, witches, goblins, skeletons, boo! But Easter, oh bunnies! Oh, we get a color Easter. I hate coloring Easter eggs. Mine all turn out kind of grayish. I'm like, oh, I'm going to mix this color and this color and... Well, it was gray. All right. Well, I'm going to do this color and this color. That's a different shade of gray. Mine are easy to find. They're gray. But if our focus on Sunday, we get up, we go to church, and we celebrate the resurrected life of our Savior, but we can't wait to get home and eat ham. Think about that for a moment, really. We're going to eat ham. Okay? And we're sitting here counting down the clock. Let's see, it takes me 7.5 minutes to get home from church. Oh, Dave's sitting by the back door, so it's going to take me an additional 3.5 minutes to get past Dave. No, Benjamin's over there. Hopefully he won't grab me to hug me before I leave. I better work that in. Okay, that's another 2.5 minutes. He's a hugger. Out to the car. Oh, wait a minute. I forgot about my wife. I better add an additional 12 minutes. Okay, so 7.5 plus 3.5, that's 11, plus 2 is 13, plus 12.5, that's 25.5 minutes. You know, and all the time it took you to figure that out, you just wasted 3 minutes. But if that is your focus, you have completely been taken in. Completely. Absolutely taken in. Is there a problem with Easter egg hunts? Absolutely not. Jeepers criminy. Go find the eggs. Find all of them, because if you don't, they stink. Is there a problem eating a chocolate Easter bunny? Heck no. You can eat chocolate in whatever shape it takes. I don't know why, but you can. Now, jelly beans, that's a different story. Yeah, give me your jelly beans. You can have my chocolate bunny. I'll eat the jelly beans. Those are not the problem. That's not the issue. The issue is, where is your heart? Is your reality based in Jesus Christ and what we are celebrating on that day? Because, see, here's the miracle of what happened that day. God has presented to you forgiveness. Absolutely unqualified, complete, total forgiveness. Absolutely nothing you can do to earn it. There's nothing you can do to add to it. There's nothing you can do to take away from it. It's either yours or it's not. Okay? Because when he went to the cross, he died for all sin. Okay? But you have to decide whether or not you're going to accept that. Okay. He still died for it, even if you don't accept it. He still went to the cross for it. And in that, you have absolute 100% forgiveness. Not just of what you've done, not just what you will do, not just what you're doing now, but for what you are. You have gone from being an enemy of God, opposed to Him, working against Him, to being one of His very own, one who can call Him Father. one who has a right to sit on the throne with Jesus Christ. Think about that for a moment. Everything that he has opened up for you to have access to. All it takes is you saying yes, absolutely, and then dying. Whoa, dying? Yep. But see, the problem with you is you. The problem with me is me. When we come to the cross, we come to die. We come to give up everything that we think we have, even the control that we think we have. And trust me, there's no bigger fool than a person that says, I'm in control of my own life. Think so? Try not paying your taxes. You give up all of that, which is really nothing, and you take on everything that he has. Everything. Because everything that he has for you is good. Whoa. He says that we're going to face hardship. You betcha you're going to face hardship. Why? So you can be better. So that you can see that the faith that you have is the most valuable thing ever. It's the only thing of value. So that your faith will be tested and refined and come forth as pure gold. So you're giving up not much, really, if we're honest, not anything. And you're taking on everything that he has for you. Look over Africa. Man, people that take this on are dying. Yeah, they get promoted to the front of the line to enter into glory first. They get to rush into the embrace of their Father first. Now here, I'll really trip you up. The people that killed him, he died for their sins too.
Amen.
He died for their sins too. So as inheritors of forgiveness, when you come to Christ, you receive his forgiveness. Do you forgive? Do you forgive? Yeah, it's not enough to be hopefully. It's a requirement. It's a requirement. The end of the Lord's Prayer, the book of Matthew. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. He goes on to say, by the measure you forgive, you will be forgiven. Now, let me clarify this. This is something that I am convinced is moving on two entirely different levels. Okay? For the unbeliever, this doesn't make any sense at all because they've not received any forgiveness. Their unforgiveness will be held against them as sin. For the believer, it's about faith. It's about quality of life in your Christian walk. All right? When you are walking around with unforgiveness, you are taking bondage and bearing it with you. You're dragging around chains that you have willingly put around yourself, and you're carrying a heavy, heavy burden that is not yours to carry. Okay? So for the Christian, God is calling you. He wants for you good. And so when he says you've got to forgive, he's not saying that because you haven't been hurt. He absolutely understands the depth of your hurt. As a matter of fact, he feels it more than you do. Because any sin committed is committed against God first. As a matter of fact, Psalm 51, David is writing this psalm after the sin with Bathsheba. Okay? He takes a married woman, has relations with her. She gets pregnant. Uh-oh. He calls her husband home in the hopes to dupe people. Hey, Uriah, how's it going, buddy? Hey, good, all right, good report. Why don't you go home and know your wife? But Uriah was a man of greater honor in that moment than David. And he went and he slept in the city gate. They went, what are you doing? You got to go home. How can I go home? My brothers are out fighting a war. I can't go home. Why should I get to enjoy the things that they don't get to enjoy? Oh, okay, well, you know what? Since you're going to go back, let me have you bear a message to the commander, Joab. Kill the dude. David, love David. There you go. All right. And he bore his own death sentence and was killed. All right. All right. Close one. Now, Bathsheba and I can get married because she's a widow. And then the pregnancy will be okay. Except for God, who said, no, it doesn't work that way. Okay, so Bathsheba delivers the baby. God says, I'm taking the baby. Was that mean of God? Really, think about this for a moment. What kind of life would the baby have had? Known to be illegitimate, known to be the reason that his father was killed. God promoted that one much quicker. So when the baby dies, David writes a psalm. Now, interestingly enough, in this psalm, he doesn't say, God, I repent. I'm sorry for the sin I did to Bathsheba. I'm sorry for what I did to Uriah. I'm sorry even because of what I did, the baby died. What does he say? He says, God, against you and you only have I sinned. Wow. Can you imagine that? So the hurt that you have, God feels so much more than you do because it was an offense against him first. Okay? Let's take a look at a passage in the book of Matthew. If you would turn with me. We're going to go to Matthew 18. So we're in the book of Matthew, chapter 18. I'm going to start in verse 21. Then Peter came up and said to him, being Jesus, Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, I do not say to you seven times, but 77 times. Quit keeping count. Okay? I know there's some of you out there that are like, okay, she's on 43. Oops, 44. Okay? Because you got to listen to this in context. He's not giving us a threshold whereby at that point unforgiveness is allowable. Okay? So, I do not say to you seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, okay? He put the therefore on purpose because he's tying these two thoughts together. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. And since he could not pay, his master ordered him to be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and payment to be made. So the servant fell on his knees, imploring him, "Have patience with me. I will pay you everything." Insert right there, liar. Okay? Because we're going to talk about that here in just a second. And out of pity for him, the master of that servant released him and forgave him the debt. But when the same servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him, he began to choke him, saying, "Pay what you owe." So his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you." He refused and went and put him in prison until he should pay his debt. When his fellow servants saw what had taken place, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their master all that had taken place. Then his master summoned him and said to him, "You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. And should not you have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you?" And in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. Okay? See, what Jesus is doing for us is he's laying out a very clear illustration of the balance scales. Okay? Because God is the king in this parable. You are the first servant. Okay? You need to understand that. You can't read this with any other interpretation. You are the first servant. Okay, that kind of changes how you read this passage. Because you are called to accounts before the king, and you are owing a debt. Now, I've looked at a bunch of different things. The one that I like the best, as to the balance of these debts, the one that I like the best is somebody actually worked it out mathematically according to how much they earned. Okay? So, at the time of this writing, 100 denarii... were about one-third of a year's salary. Okay? Seems to work. So this guy, he went and he took, he said, okay, about $35,000 a year is about what the average person is making. So one-third of that being just over $10,000, maybe $11,000 give or take, is what the second servant owed the first servant. That's a pretty good amount of money. Well, if we follow that same thing through, what the first servant owed the king came out to about $1.7 billion. Okay? So when he says, "Be patient with me, I will pay you everything," there's no way in his life, or even the life of his children, or grandchildren, or great-grandchildren, that debt would ever be paid. Okay? So you get the idea of scale here? $1.7 billion compared to $11,000. Now, your hurt is $11,000. And that's a massive amount. Some of you. The grievous hurt done to you is about 11,000. And that's heavy. Some of us, we take that 11,000 and we convert it to pennies. Can you imagine $11,000 worth of pennies? And you're carrying them around with you every day? Every day. And yet, the debt that you owe God is something you can never pay. And he says to you, "Look, I am willing to completely wipe your debt away." As a matter of fact, when Jesus hung on the cross, he said, "It is finished." That's an accounting term. All right? It literally means paid in full. Debt's paid. It is finished. So the master has already wiped away our debt. What right do we have to not wipe away what's owed us? What right? But you don't understand what I've been through. You're right. You're right. Some of you have gone through stuff I have never had to deal with. And I pray, God, I never have to deal with. I'm not making light of your debt, your hurt. But what I want you to understand is that before God, the unforgiveness you're bearing for that is so minimal compared to the forgiveness that he's already given you. Absolutely, completely. He didn't say, I'm going to take off the first 30 years of your debt, and then you'll owe me the rest. He didn't defer payments. He didn't restructure the deal to give you a lower interest rate. He completely wiped out the debt. Okay? Well, but Pastor, how do I forgive? You work at it. What do you mean you work at it? One, you got to quit playing with that thing in your brain. You got to quit playing with it. It's like a wound that you just kind of keep poking at. Now, the wound may be a bruise. Ooh, yeah, that's still sore. Well, that thing may be a wide open, gaping, gushing mess. And you're like, hey, look at this. I can touch my heart. Is it still there? Oh, yep, still there. Yep, still wounded, still bleeding. Oh, look at that, it fell out. And you play with it. And you harbor it, and you dwell on it. Get it out of your brain. Well, how do I do it? Look, with the exception of men watching sports, God has not created your brain to exist in a vacuum. Okay? Women, soap operas. You do the same thing. All right? God has not existed this to be empty. He wants it to function. He wants it to work. So I've got a little demonstration for you. For those of you that have been in marriage group, you'll get this. We're going to do it a little bit different. Would you go ahead and put it up? There we go. What is that? That's a chimp. And he's happy because he doesn't have to listen to me. That's the monkey here know anything. All right? What's the monkey doing? Show me. What's the monkey doing? Everybody, show me. Come on. Come on, everybody. Some of you guys are just sad. All right. Now, don't think about the monkey. All right? Don't think about the monkey. What's the monkey doing? I saw you look up. You're thinking about the monkey. Quit thinking about the monkey. What kind of monkey is it? What? It's a chimp. It's a chimp, and he's doing this. All right? This is the way we deal with forgiveness, all right? The sin done against us. It's always in front of us. So what we're going to do is we're going to change the picture. Oh. It still poops. They're cute puppies. They're so soft and cuddly, and they got puppy breath, and it's so cute when they eat my furniture. And they poop, and I'm walking in my bare feet, and finally, they're so cute. We love the puppy. Okay? Do you get the idea here? You have in your mind one thing, you have got to replace it with another. flip open to Philippians chapter 4. Because see, I'm not doing this in vain. This is actually a scriptural principle. You want to know how to get over unforgiveness? First thing you got to do, starting in verse 4, chapter 4, Philippians. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Okay, you pick up that rejoice is kind of important because he repeats it. Okay? When somebody repeats something, it's because it's important. Okay? So we rejoice in the Lord. How often do we do that?
Always.
Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything. So what are we to be anxious about? Nothing. But in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. So what are we supposed to present to God?
Everything.
Everything. What do we get to keep for ourselves?
Nothing.
Nothing. What do we give to God?
Everything.
Everything. Paul is speaking in absolutes here. Okay? There's no way to get around this. There's no part that you get to hold on to. So we bring everything to God, our prayers and our supplications, with thanksgiving. Okay? That's important. God always takes something away so he can replace it with something else. And if you have thanksgiving in your life, I guarantee you, you're not going to be whining and griping and grumbling and complaining. You're spending too much time being thankful. Now, Tuesday, we went to Missoula. Shay was delivering Isla.
She's so cute. And she poops.
She's beautiful. And Tuesday, we were driving around. We were watching Judah and Declan. And I got to tell you, mothers of small children, God bless you. Fathers of small children, God bless you. He has given you incredible strength, energy, and endurance. And he took it from me. But man, I cannot keep up. We had four people keeping up with those two children. I came home after brother's meeting Thursday night. I'm like, I get to go to brother's meeting. You got to watch your kids. And I get home and Christy is literally sprawled in her chair. Hi, babe.
Hi.
How you doing? I'm fine. Everything okay?
Yep.
But on Tuesday, we're driving around, and I'm thinking, you know, I've had my truck for almost 10 years. It'll be 10 years in October. Thinking, wow, you know, I have never had a problem with this truck except letting Trevor drive it. I've never had a problem with this truck. And it was a conscious thought. Thank you, God, for this truck. Tuesday morning, Wednesday morning, we get up to go to take Christy to women's Bible study and to come to discipleship. And Christy goes out and starts the truck and starts up perfect. And Benjamin was getting ready to leave. And he goes out and he's starting his car. And I'm hearing, rah, 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 rah. I was like, oh, rah, 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 rah. Hey, and I actually said, hey, sweetie, we might have to take Benjamin wherever he needs to go because his car's not starting. He comes walking in and I'm ready. Dad, can you take me? And he says, Dad, your truck won't start. That took me a minute to process. My truck won't start. Can you put that in simple terms for me? My truck won't start. Oh, he didn't turn the key right. You did turn the key, right? Yeah? Well, that's weird. He doesn't have to touch. So I go out and I... Shoot. Truck won't start. I know. I'll get Christy to do it. Sweetie, come here. Try and start the truck. It didn't work for her either. That truck won't start. Steve came over. I thought, man, Steve will intimidate it into working. Come on, Elizabeth! You gotta work! My truck's name is Elizabeth. Okay? She didn't start for Steve. He had tools and everything. All I had was my Bible. I'm like, oh man, I'm gonna preach you to death. So we still have Christy, me, Judah, Declan, Thaddeus. We've got to get Christy to the women's Bible study. We got to get Judah and Declan to babysitting, and Thaddeus and I got to get to discipleship. So Christy calls Mackenzie and says, hey, can you come home? We'll take you back to work so we can have your car to take the kids and do the, and our car is tiny. Thaddeus didn't need a seatbelt. He was wedged in so tightly he couldn't move. Take a deep breath, son. I'll shut the door. You gotta hold it till we get to church. We didn't dare roll out a window. He'd have popped out. So we get the running done. And I Mackenzie's car's name is Bianca. And I harass her about Bianca. Bianca is abused and has had a rough life, especially since Mackenzie has owned her. And she has a paralytic face, and she kind of looks at you like this. And Mackenzie said, yes, Dad, but she runs. You got me. Now, first, I was thanking God on Tuesday because of a truck that was dependable. And Wednesday morning, it was almost laughable. I had a horrible Tuesday night, a horrible Wednesday morning, and then the truck wouldn't start. It was almost laughable. It's like, okay, God, what are you trying to say? I was thanking you! It's supposed to get better, not worse. But we always had a vehicle to get everyone where they needed to go when they needed to go. And I realized it's not my truck that's dependable. It's my God.
Amen.
Okay? It's my God. So, with thanksgiving. Okay? So here's condition, here's result. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, means you can't figure it out, so don't try, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Will guard your hearts and your minds. I love that because it covers what you think and what you feel. Okay? Now here's the key that I want you to really focus on. Finally. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Okay? So, you have a choice. I'm laying a choice out before you right now, here today. It's a choice that God has already laid out in His Word. You can continue with the monkey of unforgiveness and carrying that thing around with you and bearing the burden, bearing those chains, having your quality of relationship with God and with other people being diminished, or you can choose to apply what He has just given us in His Word, replace the yuck with good, and have peace despite what has been done you. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not excusing anything anybody did to you. Before God, they're accountable. Okay? And honestly, our heart should be that before God, they find his forgiveness before they stand before his judgment. Okay? But for you, there is a peace that you cannot understand. That thing pops into your head? No. I am not going to think about this. What is true? What is pure? What is lovely? What is commendable? What is excellent? What is praiseworthy? Make a list. Write them down. Carry it with you. When that thing pops in your head, start reading your list. Start looking at it. No, these are the things I'm going to think about. When that thing pops in your head, start quoting scripture. You can't quote scripture? Start memorizing scripture. Start memorizing it. Commit it to your brain. Let it seep into your soul. When those things come up, have something to do battle with. No, I will not choose to dwell on this. I'm going to choose to dwell on this. Thank you, God, for the forgiveness of my debt. That everything that I have ever done and will ever do, you have already wiped away. That before you, I stand absolutely 100% completely righteous. Not with the righteousness that's mine, but with his. Absolutely 100%. How then can I bear unforgiveness toward my brother? Well, he owes me $11,000 and change. God, help me to forgive them. Help me in my heart not just to forget, but to forgive. To let go of the bonds that I've been clinging to, for however long you've been clinging to them. Help me to let go of them. Help me to choose to live in the life of your spirit that you have given me. And dwell there. Because that's where there is safety and security and refuge. Amen.
Amen.
Father, we bless you today. We thank you, God, that we have forgiveness such as we have never known. Father, such as we have never been able to comprehend or even apprehend. You have given it to us. All of our debt paid. Nothing is owing. We are free. We are free. We are free. Help us, Father, to let go of anything that would bind us. Help us, Father, to release those that would owe us debt. Help us, Father, to commit them into your hand and let go of them with ours. Help us to dwell in peace. We bless you, Father, and we thank you. In Jesus' name.